CNN's senior political reporter, Dana Bash, our chief political correspondent, retired Rear Admiral John Kirby, CNN military and diplomatic analyst, Michelle Kaczynski, our senior diplomatic correspondent, and Phil Mudd, CNN counterterrorism analyst. You know, John Kirby, the French President Macron, he's saying he has proof, in his words, proof that not only were chemicals used in that attack against civilians, but that Bashar al-Assad was responsible, was behind it. Describe what that proof might be, because we've all seen the horrific video of these kids suffering, but what about the proof?
I think the video is part of the proof. I think he's probably got testimony and talked to some of the medical professionals on the ground, no question about that. They've been very public about what they've been seeing and how they have treated those who have survived it. There's no question that Assad has significant still chlorine at his disposal that can be weaponized. And it's an industrial agent, but weaponizing it is still against international law. And if you just look at some of that video, it has all the signs of what would be a chlorine attack. And when Macron said that, he said we have evidence of at least chlorine. So the frothing at the mouth, the red eyes, the respiratory problems that some of the survivors had, all that certainly indicates just from a circumstantial look at it as evidence of chlorine.
How far is the State Department, Michelle, going and saying there's 100% proof that Assad was responsible for this poison gas attack and potentially that the Russians knew about it?
Yeah, well, we're not going to hear them go that far at this point, but they sounded very close to that the last time we heard them talk about this. I mean, they said that they have evidence that this is the Syrian regime, and they stated that pretty definitively. I mean, they didn't leave a whole lot of room in there for it to be anything different.
What do you think, Phil? Because you used to work at the CIA. A lot of people are skeptical when the U.S. says it has hard, concrete, evidence of weapons of mass destruction.
Sure, but there's a couple of additional characteristics here. If you look at the intelligence, typically in intelligence, you're looking at things like human sources, intercepted communications. Admiral Kirby's talking about photographs, imagery we might have. In this situation, you might also have people on the ground, for example, humanitarian workers who are reporting. They might be getting samples. So the array of intelligence here doesn't just fit into the classic secret stuff. The variety of stuff, and remember, the French have a long history of presence on the ground in Lebanon and Syria. The array of stuff the French could have access to passing the United States is pretty broad.
And it's also the way this was delivered. When you look at how it happened and also the activity surrounding hospitals, the attack on ambulances, I mean, it does leave very little room for this to be orchestrated by anything other than a regime.
It's interesting, Dana, because the president seems to be sending some conflicting signals about U.S. military action. Let me read that tweet that he put out earlier this morning. Never said when an attack on Syria would take place. Could be very soon or not so soon at all. In any event, the United States, under my administration, has done a great job of ridding the region of ISIS. Where is our thank you, America? Earlier in the week, he did use the words, very soon.
I think the diplomatic term for this is clean up on aisle nine. I mean, there's no question that he understood the pushback and the dangerous precedent and perhaps ramifications for the tweet that he sent, the impulse that he had to do what he did yesterday for whatever reason in effectively telegraphing that there will be some military response very soon, not only is something that he made fun of every single leader for doing when he was running for president, but also something that the people who were in and around him were obviously very uncomfortable with, not just when it comes to the United States, but maybe even more importantly, and I've heard you talk about this, Admiral Kirby, when it comes to our allies and when it comes to the very necessary coalition you need for any kind of robust action and trying to stop Assad, particularly because you already have, you have factions that are pretty well drawn. You have Iran, you have Russia, you have Assad, and then you have kind of everybody else. And the president needs to keep that everybody else and feel that they can be trusted.
Earlier in the week, the president did say, get ready the next 24 to 48 hours. He specifically said the next 24 to 48 hours, you'll see something. It's been now more than 48 hours.
It's been now more than 48 hours. He also kind of telegraphed that something would happen because he canceled that overseas trip and said that he had to monitor world affairs and, and monitor and oversee the Syria response. We heard this candidate Trump and then President Trump say over and over that he wouldn't telegraph what the kind of response he was going to make. We heard criticisms from John McCain essentially saying because the president said at one point that he wanted people out of Syria, that may have given Assad some assurances that the U.S. didn't want to have any further involvement in Syria and caused Assad to do this and that regime over there to do this heinous act. So, yeah, I mean, the president is all over the place with this. And then you have Jim Mattis essentially saying no decision has yet been made and presenting what is typically a response from a leader, basically saying there is still conversation and coalition building to happen.
And unfortunately, this coincides with what is going on in the domestic front in a big way. Not just the fact that the president is obviously worked up about the raid on his personal attorney's office and hotel room, but also the notion that he's gotten so much pushback for not saying very much about Vladimir Putin at all. Now he's finally doing it as it relates to what happened in Syria. But the question is not only is it too little too late, but is he doing that as a way to try to show finally that there was no collusion because he's willing to stand up to Vladimir Putin.
And we just want to point out to our viewers, you're looking at members of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee. They're now walking in to that hearing room up on Capitol Hill. It's about to begin the confirmation hearing for Mike Pompeo, the CIA director, to become the next Secretary of State. The chairman of the Foreign Relations Committee, Senator Bob Corker of Tennessee, he'll gavel this session into order. He'll make a statement. Bob Menendez, the Democratic senator from New Jersey, the ranking Democrat, he'll make a statement. There'll be some other supporters of Pompeo who will speak, Senator Pat Roberts, former Senator Bob Dole, Senator Richard Burr, chairman of the Senate Intelligence Committee, they will speak. Then Pompeo will make his opening statement. And then for the next 5 or 6 hours, there will be a lot of tough questions for the CIA director that will be asked. As we get ready for this, hovering over all of this, John Kirby, is a military strategy. If the president, the commander-in-chief, gives the order, do something in Syria right now, it's clear. And here we see Mike Pompeo walking into the hearing room right now with his aides surrounded by security. If the president gives that order, it's not that simple. You could certainly just launch a few Tomahawk cruise missiles. But if you're going to do more than that,
right,
there are potential complications. There are Russian troops there, Iranian troops there, Hezbollah troops there. It could get very, very dicey.
It is. Even in a normal, a year ago it was dicey, but now it's even more dicey because the Russians have had a year now to improve their air defenses in the region, to bolster Assad's forces. They can make it much more complicated on the targeting front. It may not be so easy to just hit a discreetly Syrian target now because the Russians and Iranians might be co-located. So everything is harder this year than it was last year, not to mention, as Dana brought up, you've got allies who are probably going to participate. They bring different capabilities, and force protection of them and their forces also becomes a little bit more complicated.
What do you think, Michelle, we'll hear from Pompeo this morning about a potential U.S. military strike against some targets in Syria?
I think he's going to be in support of that. I think he's going to be as caged in as possible on stepping beyond the bounds because he's trying to prove to these Democrats and many Republicans that he is not too hawkish. Mm-hmm. I mean, for something like this, of course, the nominee is always going to try to strike a perfect balance, but it's even more critical now since he's facing these issues in the past. He was questioned for his nomination for the CIA director, and there were a number of questions that he didn't really answer fully on exactly these kinds of sensitive issues, on Iran, on surveillance, on his stance towards Russia. It goes on and on. So they're going to dig deeper and deeper, and he's going to have to find that balance.
And you said Democrats and Republicans. The one I'm going to be watching is Rand Paul,
he's already said he's going to vote against it.
He said he's going to vote against it, but he has a platform because he sits on this committee to really press Pompeo on these issues of surveillance, but maybe not so much, that would probably be his issue because that is Rand Paul's big issue, but on broader worldview issues with regard to this administration. Yeah. So that's going to be a really fun.
But time. Nia, even if he loses Rand Paul, which he almost certainly will, Rand Paul has said he's going to oppose his nomination, and even if John McCain, let's say, who's recovering from brain cancer out in Arizona, he can't show up for a vote, there will presumably be some moderate Democrats who will support this nominee. There were 15 who supported his nomination for CIA director.
That's right, and a lot of those were those red state Democrats who are up for re-election in states that Donald Trump won by a whopping margin, so they did vote for Pompeo. We'll see. I mean, we have two on this committee, Tim Kaine and Gene Shaheen, who did vote for Pompeo to be the CIA director, so it'll be interesting to see what their questioning of him is. Are they still going to vote for him? Are they looking for ways to draw him out in a way that they would be in conflict with him to not vote for him? So we'll see. Somebody else to look for, Dianne Feinstein, who voted for Mike Pompeo, but now is getting pressure from